Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents America's Forgotten Pandemic, The Influenza of 1918, Second Edition, by Alfred W. Crosby. Narrated by Rick Adamson. Publisher's Note: This audiobook refers to figures, graphs, and tables included in the print and ebook editions of the book. Preface to the New Edition. In 1976, when this book was first published, it seemed to be a piece of medical antiquarianism. Informative and interesting, I hoped, but with little immediate relevancy to our then-current situation. In the advanced nations, the chief killers were no longer infections, not even renowned villains like tuberculosis, much less influenza. Public health measures and penicillin and the other new antibiotics had demoted all the major pathogens to minor threats. They had been superseded by the degenerative diseases of middle and old age, such as cancer and arteriosclerosis. We weren't looking forward to these, but we were confident that we would be around long enough to get old and die of them. In 1969, the Surgeon General of the United States, William H. Stewart, assured us that we had left infectious disease behind in our dust. 3 years later, in the final edition of the classic Natural History of Infectious Disease, author and Nobel laureate McFarlane Burnett concluded that the most likely forecast about the future of infectious disease is that it will be very dull. There was the swine flu scare of 1976 that for a few months contradicted such optimism. The flu experts told us that we might be on the brink of another experience like that of 1918, when life expectation in the United States plunged by 20 years. But the strain of virus that triggered the swine flu scare did not trigger a pandemic, and the millions of dollars spent on the production and distribution of a new flu vaccine were wasted. To many outsiders, the whole affair seemed farcical, and the influenza experts and gloom purveyors emerged from the experience with bedraggled reputations. A less significant effect was that my study of the 1918 pandemic lost the patina of contemporary relevancy it had possessed for a while. I didn't mourn the loss. Rooting for a medical disaster because it might help book sales would certainly have qualified me for residency somewhere in the lower circles of Dante's hell. The first Cambridge University Press edition of my book came out in 1989, by which time events had resuscitated the study of infection. AIDS had struck like a thunderbolt, infected legions, and killed thousands, and there was no cure or promise of one. For some of us, the malady recalled to memory what the Surgeon General of the United States Army, Victor Vaughn, had written about the peak of the 1918 pandemic. At that moment, I decided never again to prate about the great achievements of science. But AIDS was a sexually transmitted disease and presented little danger to anyone with a strong sense of self-preservation. To most, it seemed an exception that served to highlight the comfortable ordinary. The experts with white coats and stethoscopes still had things under control, and we would last until the degenerative maladies got us. For certain, the 1918 flu was ancient history, and no more pertinent to our lives than the sweating sickness of Tudor England. In 2003, that confidence is shaking in its boots. AIDS afflicts millions, and the white coats still cannot cure it, although they can prolong its victims' lives for years. Tuberculosis, under control a generation ago, has made a comeback with the surfacing of antibiotic-resistant strains. Thugs we never heard of before, Lyme disease and West Nile fever, for example, stalk us in our backyards and parks where we picnic, and jungle monsters like Ebola threaten us from TV screens. The latest fright is SARS, severe acute respiratory syndrome, at first suspected of being a new strain of influenza. It isn't. but the disease is transmitted by droplets in the breath, like flu, that is to say, stealthily and swiftly. As I write this, SARS has spread from southern China, allegedly its point of origin, to other locations in eastern Asia and to North America and Europe. It is well on its way to circling the globe in a matter of weeks. SARS has flu-like symptoms, runny nose, sore throat, aches, and fever. There doesn't seem to be any cure more effective than bed rest, as was so with the 1918 flu. A careful and conservative estimate of those who died of influenza in the World War I pandemic puts the number at a minimum of 30 million, three times the number of combat casualties of that conflict. Today, we have antibiotics to cure the deadly secondary infections that so often followed on the heels of the 1918 flu, which should reduce the death rate of any similar pandemic. We know vastly more about that flu virus than we did that year or when I first wrote about it. Dr. Jeffrey Taubenberger, Ann Reed, and their associates have examined tissue samples preserved since 1918 to 19 by the U.S. Armed Forces Museum of Pathology in Maryland and by the permafrost in Alaska, and have reconstructed much of the genome of the pandemic virus. We have vigilant worldwide surveillance systems, like Japan's National Institute of Infectious Diseases, the United States Centers for Disease Control, and the World Health Organization, to watch for new flu epidemics and new strains of viruses. We have institutions to produce vaccines to counter any new strains. We are even making some progress in at least ameliorating the effects of viral diseases like influenza. But we don't know yet what made the 1918 virus so dangerous, and so we don't know yet what to do to stall the return of that or any similarly dangerous flu virus. Furthermore, we live in a world that has become, in some ways, a better place for nasty viruses and a worse place for us than it was in 1918. The flu virus seems a poor choice for bioterrorism, but our globalized transportation systems increase the probability of natural pandemics of influenza. In 1918, the fastest way to cross oceans was by steamship. In 2003, thousands of us daily and tens of millions of us annually make such trips in aircraft at speeds not far short of that of sound, carrying with us in our lungs and bowels, on our hands and in our hair, microorganisms of all kinds, including pathogens. We are all, so to speak, sitting in the waiting room of an enormous clinic, elbow to elbow with the sick of the world. The world's human population is more than three times greater than it was in the last year of World War I, which increases the likelihood of the spread of strains of any and all pathogens. The populations of the animals with which we exchange flu viruses, the source of epidemic strains, are vastly larger than they were in 1918. China, which tops the world in its numbers of humans, aquatic birds, and pigs, has been the source of many new flu strains since 1918, and will be again. The health problems of our giant cities are especially daunting. Consider Mexico City, with a population of 19 million officially, and several million more than that in reality. That is to say, a population considerably greater than those of Norway, Sweden, and Denmark added together. Such megalopoli are sprouting rankly across the world, most spectacularly in the regions where the facilities and income are insufficient to take the most effective measures to control disease. There is a bitter little pill of a joke currently circulating among infectious disease experts. It is short. The 19th century was followed by the 20th century, which was followed by the 19th century. The medical optimism circa 1976 is receding. America's forgotten pandemic has, at last, attained contemporary relevancy. Part 1. An Abrupt Introduction to Spanish Influenza. Chapter 1. The Great Shadow. William Henry Welch was the most distinguished pathologist, physician, and scientist in the United States in the early years of the 20th century. He was, at one time or another, president of the American Medical Association and of the Association of American Physicians, and his renown among medical scientists was equaled by his fame among all scientists, which won him the presidencies of the American Association for the Advancement of Science, the National Academy of Science, and the Board of Directors of the Rockefeller Institute. Doyen of all the American sciences, his like, in that respect, had not been seen since Benjamin Franklin. Despite the urgency of existing obligations, Dr. Welch left his post at Johns Hopkins to answer President Wilson's call to fight the war to end all wars, and, along with millions of men a half and a third his age, put on the olive drab of the United States Army. In 1918, his job was troubleshooting for the Army Surgeon General, traveling about the nation, inspecting the sanitary conditions in the camps so abruptly gouged out of America's open spaces to provide its plowboys and jitney drivers with places to learn the skills of trench warfare. The job wasn't glorious, but it was a very important one because in all previous wars, more American soldiers had died of disease than in combat, and history would surely repeat itself unless constant and careful inspections of the camps were made. So the man whom the medical profession knew as the nation's most prestigious pathologist checked on the thoroughness with which prostitutes had been routed out of cantonment neighborhoods, stared into latrine pits, tested the temperature of mess hall dishwater, and measurably assisted the medical corps in holding the line against infectious disease. The health of the Army proved to be as good as any reasonable doctor could expect, and the procedures to preserve it so exemplary that by the last month of summer 1918, the good gray physician was ready to take off his uniform and return to his civilian duties. Then, something new in the way of a threat to that health appeared, first striking at Camp Devens in Massachusetts, then spreading to Camps Upton, New York, and Lee, Virginia. The Surgeon General's office dispatched Colonel Welch to Devens to find exactly what was the cause of the hair-raising telegrams originating there. By the time he arrived on September 23rd, the disease, it was being called Spanish influenza, was reported among civilians from Maine to Virginia, and news of it was coming in from scattered locations all over the nation. The number and quality of the medical experts converging on Devens are a measure of the government's concern. Included in the group were Welch, Colonel Victor C. Vaughn, another ex-president of the American Medical Association, Rufus Cole of the Rockefeller Institute, and Simeon Walbach of the Harvard Medical School. Camp Devens, located about 30 miles west of Boston, on a well-drained plateau of meadows and woods, had only one characteristic to qualify it for the traditional military epidemic. It was overcrowded, with 45,000 men, 5,000 of them under canvas, jammed into an encampment built for 35,000. The cantonment was over capacity for the very good reason that the United States was involved in a war several times more prodigal in its appetite for fighting men than any previous war in history, where General Grant had called for hundreds of thousands of American soldiers, General Pershing and his French superior, General Foch, called for millions. 35,000 officers and men had already trained at Devens in the first year of its existence, and almost all of them were already in France. Now the training of the brand new 12th Infantry Division was underway, to the distant thunder of America's first major offense of the war, the Battle of Saint Mihiel. The 12th's commander, Major General Henry P. McCain, had arrived at Devens at 10 a.m. on August 20th, and announced his firm intention to have the division ready for embarkation to France in 14 weeks, Range firing would be carried on all hours of the day while it is light enough to see a bullseye. 3 weeks later, he found himself commander not of a division well on its way to becoming the crack outfit of his dreams, but of a division which was very sick and possibly getting sicker faster than any other similar outfit in the world. Word of Spanish influenza was heard from Boston as early as the very first days of September, but when the first Devon's victim, a soldier of Company B, 42nd Infantry, went on sick call on the 7th, his illness was diagnosed as cerebrospinal meningitis. The abruptness of the onset of the disease, and the degree to which it overwhelmed the patient, the technical descriptive term is fulminating, seemed far too extreme to be attributed to influenza of any kind. After all, influenza, flu, grip, G-R-I-P-P-E, or grip, G-R-I-P, whatever you called it and however you spelled it, was a homey, familiar kind of illness. 2 or 3 days in bed, feeling downright miserable, a week or so feeling shaky, and then back to normal. Call it a bad cold or call it flu, it was an annual occurrence in most families, and not a thing of terror like smallpox or typhoid or yellow fever. Epidemic maladies like the latter were a danger, not just an inconvenience, and doctors were legally obliged to report them to their boards of health. But few health departments in the United States or the world thought enough of influenza to make it a reportable disease. The following day, a dozen men of Company B showed up at the hospital, apparently with the same sickness as their comrade, and medical officers began to question the original diagnosis. The fever, headache, prostration, and abruptness of onset of meningitis were there, but the most obvious external symptoms were those of disease of the upper respiratory tract, cough, drippy nose, sore throat. The patients complained of aching backs and legs. On September 12th, a definite diagnosis of influenza was made. By September 16th, 36 members of Company B had been sent to the hospital with influenza, and the disease had spread to other companies and regiments. Daily hospital admissions, only 31 on the second day of the month, soared to 142 on the 10th, and to a peak of 1,176 on the 18th. By that day, 6,674 cases of influenza had been reported in Devon's. Influenza often spreads explosively. That is the most obvious sign by which to differentiate between it and the usual run of bad colds. But the 1918 flu was unique in one way at least. No other influenza before or since has had such a propensity for pneumonic complications. And pneumonia kills. The news that greeted Welch when he arrived at Devon's on September 23rd was that 12,604 cases of Spanish influenza had been officially reported since the 7th of the month. How many more mild cases were still in the barracks spreading the epidemic, no one could say, but at least the number of new cases of flu being reported was falling off. That number was down 250 from the previous day and had been dropping since the 20th. But the spread of pneumonia was accelerating. The hospital's clerical system was breaking down under the volume of paperwork created by the epidemic, but Colonel Welch could be told that there were at least 727 cases of pneumonia. When the clerks finally caught up with the pneumonia statistics 4 days later, they discovered that the hospital had 1,902 cases of pneumonia under its care, and the number was still rising. The Boston Globe reported that in the 24 hours preceding 7 a.m. of September 23rd, 66 men, all of them probably in the peak years of physical prowess, had died. The statistics boggled Welch's mind. The sight of lines of sick men shuffling through the cold, penetrating rain to the hospital gave him no encouragement about the immediate future. He needed no stethoscope to conclude that the problem for many of them was lung failure. He could see that at a dozen paces. some of them stumbling along, the blankets over their shoulders soaking up the fine drizzle, were turning blue and even purple. And when the sick reached the hospital, where was there room to put them? And how many physicians and nurses were there to care for them? The hospital was typical of those thrown together by the army, a maze of dozens of wooden buildings connected by what seemed miles of corridors. One physician, after the war, looked back in bitterness to comment, "A farmer who gave no more thought to the planning of his milking barns than was given to the planning of army hospitals in World War I would go broke in a month." The Devon's hospital normally accommodated 2,000. Now, 8,000 sick men needed shelter and treatment. The wards overflowed onto the porches, and when those filled up, raw wooden drafty barracks were commandeered to serve as supplemental hospitals, or rather as places to bed down the sick until someone, anyone, could get around to caring for them. Nurses were more important than doctors because neither antibiotics nor medical techniques existed to cure either influenza or pneumonia. Warm food, warm blankets, fresh air, and what nurses ironically call TLC, tender loving care, to keep the patient alive until the disease passed away. That was the miracle drug of 1918. The Devon's Hospital had 300 regular nurses, not nearly enough to handle the tidal wave of patients, and the nurses themselves were, of course, especially susceptible to infection because they were exhausted and constantly in contact with the ill. Welch found that scores of them were down with influenza. At one time, 90 of the 300 were incapacitated. Welch and his colleagues made their inquiries, noted down the appalling statistics, 29.6% of the 13th Battalion's sick, 17.3% of the 42nd Infantry sick, 24.6% of trains and military police sick, stopped at the hospital laboratory to try to derive some wisdom from the confusion there, and glanced in at the wards with their lines of cots and prostrated soldiers, whose linens were often stained with bloody sputum and the sudden nosebleeds that were symptoms of Spanish influenza. The soldiers with the tint of blue were almost certainly dying. The tour was appalling. Colonel Vaughn, who had gone through the Spanish-American War and had seen thousands of cases of typhoid, admitted that he had never seen anything so depressing as this. Little could be learned from the sick and dying but that they were sick and dying. Enlightenment, if there was any to be had, would be found in the autopsy room. What in the name of God was happening inside the lungs of these soldiers, who a few days ago were prime specimens of possibly the most robust generation of men the human race had yet produced? Conditions in the morgue were chaotic. In an army camp, populated for the most part with recruits in their 20s, a dozen deaths a week would be a serious matter. 63 died on the day Welch came to Devon's. Presently, 90 would die in a day. Bodies the color of slate were stacked like cordwood or lying about the morgue floor in confusion, and the eminent physicians had to step around and over them to get to the autopsy room. There, Welch, who had presided over the most famous teaching laboratory for pathology in America for more years than most pathologies had practiced, labored to find the cause of death. In the open chest of a cadaver, Welch saw the blue, swollen lungs of a victim of Spanish influenza for the first time. Cause of death? That at least was clear. What in a healthy man are the lightest parts of his body, the lungs, were, in this cadaver, two sacs filled with a thin, bloody, frothy fluid. The human body is a collocation of wonders, and none is more wondrous than the lungs. Here, quite literally, the line dividing the body from its environment is thinnest. Here, the blood exchanges its gaseous wastes for the oxygen that the body needs every moment of its existence to stay alive, And here, the human organism spreads itself out to expose as thin and broad an area to the air as possible. In an adult male, the lungs contain 750 million of the tiny air sacs, the alveoli, where the gaseous exchange takes place, and their combined surface is more than 25 times the area of his skin. The capillaries of their walls are barely wider than the diameter of a single red blood cell, and the membranes of those capillaries are 0.001 meter thick. It is here in the lungs that the human body, in order to renew itself with every breath, takes on almost the delicacy of a soap bubble. The most minute tendency toward any grossness in the tissues of the alveoli, or of the structure that contains them, or any presence within them of anything but air, endangers the gaseous exchange. In the common varieties of pneumonia, which were familiar to Colonel Welch, the tissue of the lungs becomes gross, full of nodules, and often degenerates into something more like liver than the soft, light, elastic tissue of a healthy lung. Many of the dead at Devon's had lungs at least similar to the coarse, defiled lungs he had seen so many times before in autopsy, but those were from men who had died 10 days or more after the onset of influenza and after major invasions by the microorganisms commonly associated with pneumonia. The lungs of those who had died quickly, sometimes only 48 hours after the first ache and cough, were such as he had never seen before. There was little or no consolidation of the lung tissue, yet the lungs were so abnormal that pieces of them, which should have been as buoyant as a child's balloon, sank when placed in water. Their most conspicuous feature was the enormous quantity of thin, bloody fluid. It oozed out of the lungs sectioned for examination, and in the large air passages leading to the throat, it mixed with air in a bloody froth. As rigor mortis set in, the fluid often poured from the nose and stained the body wrappings. Welch was little given to fits and starts. He was the most dignified of men, as befitted a hugely successful and universally admired Victorian physician. He was, by personality, the kind of man who could, to paraphrase a writer of his generation, keep his head while all about him were losing theirs. Furthermore, he was a pathologist, and by profession accustomed to a daily routine of horrors. If there was anyone at Devon's who could be depended upon as a pillar of strength, it was this sage of Johns Hopkins. But when he saw the wet lungs of influenza pneumonia in the fall of 1918, the pillar trembled. "This must be some new kind of infection," he said, and then used one of the few words in the lexicon of medicine that still have an aura of superstitious horror, or plague. 2 decades later, Dr. Cole remembered that he hadn't been surprised that he and the other younger men had been disturbed, but it shocked me to find that the situation, momentarily at least, was too much, even for Dr. Welch. A number of medical men, on first brush with Spanish influenza, thought it was something vastly more dangerous than any kind of flu could be. A favorite guess was pneumonic plague, that form of the Black Death of medieval history which is transmitted by breath, just like influenza. Between 1910 and 1917, pneumonic plague had killed people in wholesale lots in Manchuria and China, and in the latter year, some 200,000 laborers from North China had come round the globe, many passing through North America to work in France. Maybe they had brought the plague, which, after modification by the new environment, now was appearing as the so-called Spanish influenza. Other medical men associated Spanish influenza directly with the war. Wherever his armies met in Europe, man was creating chemical and biological cesspools in which any kind of disease might spawn. Never before had such quantities of explosives been expended. Never before had so many men lived in such filth for so long. Never before had so many human corpses been left to rot above ground, and never before had anything so fiendish as mustard gas been released into the atmosphere in large amounts. That was all theory, and the immediate problem was not the origin of Spanish influenza, but how to cure it and prevent its spread. If the previous century of medical history was any measure, then the doctors at Camp Devens and their colleagues throughout the world were better prepared to deal with the problem of an epidemic than any group of healers ever before. In that 100 years, more had been learned about disease than had been learned in the thousands of years preceding. Remedies for, vaccines against, or at least methods of limiting the spread of smallpox, typhoid, malaria, yellow fever, cholera, and diphtheria had been devised and proven successful. Welch and his colleagues were the direct heirs of Jenner, Pasteur, Koch, and the great sanitationists Chadwick and Shattuck, and were contemporaries of Walter Reed and Paul Ehrlich. Welch's superior, Army Surgeon General William Crawford Gorgas, had led the forces that controlled and almost eliminated the scourge of the Caribbean, yellow fever, from Cuba and the Panama Canal Zone. Yet these doctors now stood nearly as helpless in the presence of this epidemic of Spanish influenza as Hippocrates and Galen in the presence of epidemics of their time. Welch, Vaughan, Cole, and all the physicians of 1918 were participants in the greatest failure of medical science in the 20th century, or, if absolute numbers of dead are the measure, of all time. There was no leisure for the doctors to muse on their inability to protect humanity from the malevolence of nature. The machinery of the army continued to function despite the epidemic. Men, possibly infected, were leaving Devens for other camps, and on September 25th, a new lot of draftees arrived, many of them to become victims and carriers of the disease. Welch, Vaughan, and Cole made their learned recommendations to General McCain that same day. No more troops should be ordered to Devens or dispatched to other camps from Devens. As soon as possible, the number of troops at Devens should be reduced by 10,000. Quarters for men and officers should be expanded to provide 50 square feet of floor space per individual. More doctors, nurses, and hospital space should be obtained. If General McCain had expected magic formulae, these heirs of Pasteur and Koch had none to offer. And with shortages of everything, especially medical personnel, and a division to train and orders to obey and a war to fight, he had to delay and hedge on implementing and even ignore the meager suggestions they did make. Welch returned to Washington, D.C. on September 27th as the news broke that American forces were driving into German lines in the Argonne Forest. By the end of October, over 17,000 men at Devens had contracted flu and/or pneumonia, one-third of the entire command. 787 of them died, a long way from the mud and glory of the Argonne. Colonel Welch didn't know it yet, but Americans were dying of influenza there, too. The epidemic in America was just one facet of that most awesome of nature's phenomena, a pandemic. There was little to tell the worried generals in Washington that they didn't already know. The epidemic was already rampant in the cities of the East Coast, including Washington. On the day before he left Massachusetts, Brigadier General Charles Richards, the acting Surgeon General, had informed the Chief of Staff that influenza was prevalent in 10 of the largest army camps in the nation, and that as many as 8 to 10,000 deaths could be expected. In a speech after the war, Welch said, "We of the medical profession are very proud of the achievements of the medical corps of our country. We can point to great triumphs in the control of disease. Never before has there been such an opportunity on such a large scale to demonstrate the value of vaccination against typhoid fever. We believed also we had in the anti-tetanus serum a preventative of tetanus, but it required the experience of the World War to show how completely controlled that disease was. The control of malaria around the cantonments was another triumph. He could even point with pride to the reduction of that special bane of any army, venereal disease, to a point never before realized. He spoke only briefly of influenza, that great shadow cast upon the medical profession. There was nothing in that subject for the healer to point to with pride. Influenza had killed nearly as many American servicemen as died in battle, 10 times and over that number of American civilians, and twice as many people in the world as died in combat on all fronts in the entire 4 years of the war. Part 2. Spanish Influenza, the First Wave, Spring and Summer, 1918. Chapter 2. The Advance of the Influenza Virus. Until Spanish influenza attained the status of a national catastrophe in autumn 1918, few Americans paid much attention to it. Few indeed paid heed to an epidemic of grip that had passed over the United States in the spring of 1918. The disease was mild, and there were too many other attention grabbers in the first months of 1918. In January, the president made his 14 points address, unveiling to the world the principles of a Wilsonian peace settlement. In March, the Bolsheviks submitted to a Carthaginian peace, and Russia dropped out of the war. Germany shunted division after division from east to west until it attained superiority in the number of its combat troops facing the French and English. As of March 6th, American troops held only 4.5 miles of the battlefront in France. "A terrible blow is imminent," said French Premier Georges Clemenceau to an American newspaper man. "Tell your Americans to come quickly." The Western Front, known to the British poet and soldier Robert Graves as the sausage machine, because it was fed with live men, churned out corpses, and remained firmly screwed in place, came unscrewed on March 21st. In the first 3 weeks of Germany's offensive, its troops overran 1,250 square miles of France. On March 23rd, Les Boches began lobbing shells 75 miles into Paris with their Big Bertha howitzer. For 140 days, the French army was unable to force the withdrawal of Big Bertha and end the shelling of the capital of France. The German offensive, with a few pauses for regrouping and change of direction, continued for over 4 months. German strategy was apparent to all: split the French and British forces, drive the latter into the Channel, and win the war. Allied strategy was as obvious: hang on until the Americans arrived in sufficient numbers to enable the Allies to take the offensive. The American effort to do just that was beginning to pay off just as German forces were bludgeoning their way toward Paris and the sea. In March, 84,000 Americans embarked for Europe. In April, 118,000. The greatest of races was on, and no one could know who would win. And so it wasn't surprising that few paid attention to how many were coming down with the sniffles in America in spring 1918. In March, over 1,000 workers at the Ford Motor Company in Detroit had to be sent home with influenza. At about the same time, Haskell, Kansas had 18 severe cases of flu, 3 of which, surprisingly, ended in death. In the same month, United States Public Health Service, USPHS, attempts to gather exact data on the incidence of pellagra in a South Carolina mill town were swamped under a sudden excess of bad colds and grip. In April and May, 500 of the 1,900 prisoners at San Quentin Prison in California came down with flu, and 3 of them died. The spring epidemic isn't even mentioned in the index of the 1918 volumes of the Journal of the American Medical Association. Influenza wasn't a reportable disease. The only evidence of it that was registered with the various public health departments was the deaths, and most doctors ascribed them on the death certificates to uncomplicated cases of pneumonia. There were very few of these deaths relative to the numbers sick, and pneumonia was a perfectly normal way to die before the advent of sulfa drugs and penicillin, especially in the winter and spring. In addition, there was the problem of diagnosis. In the autumn, when the second and killer wave of influenza hit, the Denver Post tried to save the city's exhausted doctors' unneeded house calls by informing its readers of how to tell a cold from flu. The onset of the former, said the Post, is not so sudden, its aches not so severe, its fever not so high, and a cold is marked by chilliness rather than definite chills. Unfortunately, a licensed physician couldn't have made the difference any clearer. Bacteriological tests weren't helpful. It was widely believed that the cause of flu was Pfeiffer's bacillus, but despite its scientific names, Bacillus influenzae and Haemophilus influenzae, the latter is still its official title, it didn't and doesn't cause influenza. Finally, the United States didn't have the network of effective, well-financed federal, state, and local public health departments to put together what data did exist on influenza and pneumonia in the spring of 1918 to provide even a sketch of the epidemic. Many of the nation's public health departments were similar to that of the state of Washington, the inefficiency of which that state's commissioner of health excused by explaining that his subordinates were paid little and their policy is to do as much as the pay justifies. The only clear picture of the spring wave of Spanish influenza came from institutions and organizations like San Quentin Prison and the Army, which had complete jurisdiction over their members and had to take care of them when they got sick. Beginning March 4, 1918, masses of soldiers at Camp Funston, Kansas, poured into the camp hospital with fever, headache, backache, and, in general, with all the symptoms of grip. Whatever it was, it fitted the old English name for flu, knock-me-down fever. For most of the soldiers, it meant 2 or 3 days of misery, and then they started improving and were soon back on duty. The flu epidemic was ominously trailed by a pneumonia epidemic, 233 cases that month, of which 48 ended in death. But that was not a remarkable mortality rate for pneumonia in 1918. And anyway, the flu cum pneumonia epidemic waned rapidly after 2 weeks, bobbing up only now and again as new lots of draftees arrived. Camps Oglethorpe, Gordon, Grant, Lewis, Sherman, Donovan, Fremont, Hancock, Kearney, Logan, McClellan, Sevier, Shelby, and others had epidemics of influenzal disease in March and April. Today, such news would galvanize the medical corps, but in 1918, it attracted only a modicum of attention. There were few similar civilian reports to put alongside the Army's and create a picture of a nationwide epidemic. And besides, epidemics of mild disease were to be expected in any military camp. Despite the rapid growth of the medical corps, when the war ended, it was larger than the entire standing army had been at the beginning of 1917, and despite an equally rapid growth in the number of soldiers in its care, it was doing a much better job than in any previous war. If vaccines and medicines and sanitation could protect American servicemen in World War I, they were protected. Of course, strict enforcement of cleanliness broke down at the front, and cooties were as common in World War I as DDT in World War II. But typhus stayed on the Eastern Front, and doughboys in France had only its mild cousin, trench fever, to trouble them. The other old scourge of war, diarrhea, was at times epidemic, but rarely fatal. In 1917 and 1918, the United States Army Medical Corps accomplished what Civil War and Spanish-American War medical officers would have called miracles, especially in the control of insect, water, and foodborne diseases. Airborne disease was something else again. If there wasn't a vaccine, as in the case of smallpox, to prevent soldiers from contracting airborne disease, then there wasn't much that could be done or that we can do today. Until September 1918, the most troublesome epidemic problem in the Army was breath-borne measles. This disease, presaging influenza, often opened the way for pneumonia, which in a large percentage of cases ended in death. The reasons were, in part, the same as those which would make influenza so dangerous. Too many men, especially from rural areas, with too few of the immunities normally acquired in urban childhood, jammed into poorly ventilated quarters. With the example of measles before it, the medical corps would probably have paid a great deal more attention to the spring wave of flu in 1918 if it had known just how widely that wave spread. Flu had been nearly omnipresent in March and April. If the death certificate files of 50 of the largest cities in the nation provide an accurate measure, in the great majority of these cities, an unanticipated number of people had died of influenza and/or pneumonia. When the Metropolitan Life Insurance Company got around to compiling statistics on death claims made against it in 1918, the same picture appeared. In the spring, something diagnosed as influenza and/or pneumonia had killed not a very great number of people, but more than epidemiologists or actuaries had predicted. The old saw, credited to a fledgling physician, that influenza is a delightful disease, quite a godsend, everybody ill, nobody dying, didn't quite apply. Was the spring flu distinctive in any other ways? There was something new about the lungs in the few postmortems performed on the spring flu and pneumonia victims. Pathologist Edwin R. LeCount of Chicago noticed it, but didn't realize its significance until he saw so many more examples in the terrible autumn. Army pathologists noticed the same thing in the spring, too, a widespread hemorrhagic and edematous process in the lungs. The distinctiveness of the spring flu is equally apparent to the historian poking around in old death certificate files. Influenza and pneumonia, when they kill, usually kill those of two extremes of life, the very young and the old. The curve of influenza and pneumonia mortality relative to age for 1917 was, as in almost every period since mortality rates have been subjected to such analysis, a crude U, high at both ends and low in the middle, as common experience suggests it should be. When an influenza epidemic or pandemic strikes, both the influenza and pneumonia mortality rates rise, but the shape of the curve remains approximately the same. Influenza and its complications still kill the young and the old more readily than those in the prime years of life. But when a curve is plotted for the incidence of flu and pneumonia deaths according to age for one of the United States cities that had a higher than normal number of such deaths in the spring of 1918, for example, Louisville, Kentucky for April, the resulting curve is not a U, but a crude W with its highest point in the middle, where both science and common sense declare it should not be. Analysis of the death certificate files for other American cities in that spring, New York City and Lowell, Massachusetts in the northeast, Birmingham in the southeast, San Francisco and Seattle on the Pacific coast, and Minneapolis in the north central, results in the same spike in the middle, usually in the 21 to 29 years of age column. For many cities, the spike was highest in April. But for New York City, the peak was in March, which is possibly significant because that city was the chief embarkation point for American troops sailing to Europe. While few took notice, something new was seeding itself in the throats and lungs of Americans that spring, which would bury more human beings than the World War. And like war, it preferred young adults as victims. Where did it come from? China, India, France? There were vague and ex post facto reports of flu or flu-like epidemics in those lands in the spring. But if we insist on contemporary documentary evidence from qualified physicians, then we must say that the new influenza appeared first in March and in the United States. It is possibly significant that the first cases of epidemic influenza in the spring in the American Expeditionary Force, AEF, which were among the very earliest in all Europe, appeared at a camp near Bordeaux, one of the chief disembarkation ports for American troops. The date was about April 15th. It may be that the doughboys were bringing more across the Atlantic than anyone realized. An epidemic of pneumonia struck in the 15th U.S. Cavalry on the voyage to Europe in March of 1918, 36 cases and 6 deaths. Private Harry T. Presley of another unit caught flu or something like it during the spring epidemic at Camp Dix, New Jersey, but didn't impress the medical officers enough to be taken off duty. That was all right for him because he had a posh office job. But his buddy, Sid Allen, who also had the grip, was ordered to keep on drilling and was still sick when they shipped out in April. He died 2 days out, and Presley never did learn whether he was buried at sea or completed his journey to France. By May, influenza had established itself on at least 2 continents. On May 9th, the 26th Division of the American Army had the misfortune of suffering a heavy gas shell attack in the midst of an epidemic of 3-day fever, as flu was called in the AEF. The fever hit the 42nd Division in the middle of the month and filled hospitals to the brim. For most, it was mild, but some developed a secondary pneumonia of a most virulent and deadly type. This new flu could be astonishingly contagious. 90% of the 168th Infantry Regiment and of the sailors of the U.S. Navy seaplane station at Dunkirk were affected to a greater or lesser degree. The disease passed from army to army with ease, appearing in the British Expeditionary Force as early as April. By May, it was so widespread among French troops that the Service de Santé Militaire took alarm and issued a directive calling for reports by telegraph of all outbreaks of la grippe. Oddly, just as the first wave of influenza was to all appearances dying out in the United States, it was beginning what was to be a much more spectacular sweep across Europe and the rest of the old world. As the Service de Santé Militaire issued its directive, the epidemic was already rolling over the Alps and Pyrenees into Italy and Spain. In a month or two, everyone outside of Spain was calling it Spanish influenza, not because it originated there, but probably because Spain, still a non-belligerent, had no wartime censorship to keep its health problems secret from the world. An estimated 8 million Spaniards caught flu in May and June. The Spanish claimed that it had come from the battlefields of France, blown over by the strong winter winds, and that it would have been even worse but for the snowy Pyrenees. The new influenza attracted little attention in Great Britain until June, when it appeared in Portsmouth and other southern coastal towns. As usual, it spread first and fastest in the military. Flu cases in the British Army in the United Kingdom had risen in May and jumped to 31,000 in June, 6 times the number for May. Influenza mortality figures for England and Wales show an abrupt rise in the latter part of June. The first Germans to be stricken were those on the extreme western extension of the territory controlled by Germany, the Western Front. Flu passed over no man's land as easily as it did nearly every man-made barrier in 1918, and the first soldiers of the Kaiser caught it in April. It laid them as flat as fast as it did the soldiers on the other side of the barbed wire, justifying the old German nickname for influenza, Blitzkatarr. It affected the war, of course. By the 10th of May, 10% of the crew members of Britain's Grand Fleet were down with it. The USS Nashville had 91 cases in a crew of 192 during a voyage from Gibraltar to Bizerte, and some American submarines had 1/3 to 1/2 of their personnel stricken while on patrol. The attack of the British 29th Division against La Bec, set for June 20th, had to be postponed because of flu. In the period May 30th to June 5th, during the German attack in the Soissons and Rhin area, the French 5th and 6th armies each day evacuated 1,500 to 2,000 stricken with La Grippe, along with thousands of wounded. For the rest of that month, the Americans and Germans fought at Belleau Wood, the former despite an epidemic of diarrhea, and the latter despite diarrhea plus influenza. The German troops had their own name for the new influenza, Flanders fever, and it was especially prevalent in the army group whose task it was to smash the Allied left wing against the Channel coast. It was a grievous business, wrote Germany's leading general, Erich von Ludendorff, having to listen every morning to the chiefs of staff's recital of the number of influenza cases and their complaints about the weakness of their troops. A bit later, he blamed the failure of his July offensive, which came so close to winning the war for Germany, on the poor morale and diminished strength of his armies, which he attributed in part to flu. In the armies of the Western Front, the first wave of influenza waned in July, just as it waxed among the civilian populations of many European nations. Flu wasn't a reportable disease in London, but we do know that in 3 weeks in July, 700 died there of flu and 475 of pneumonia. Hamburg lost 214 of its citizens to flu and pneumonia in July. There were thousands in Germany ill with Spanish influenza. Hunger caused by the British naval blockade was blamed for the sickness. The ration of the staple of the Germans' diet, potatoes, was down to 1.5 kilograms a week per person. In Switzerland, where influenza was reportable, over 53,000 cases occurred in July. In the week ending July 27th, over 8,000 cases of grippe were reported in Copenhagen, and across the Straits in Christiania, Norway, over 6,000 cases in the week ending July 13th. The London Times poo-pooed the rumor that Spanish influenza was all a German plot and blamed it largely on malnutrition and the general weakness of nerve power known as war weariness. Doctors who noted only its wide distribution and low death rate inclined to the opinion that it was just another round of the kind of flu that had been called Russian influenza in the 1890s. Doctors of a statistical bent analyzed London's mortality records and discovered that it was something unprecedented and a little frightening. It killed only a few of those it infected, but an extraordinarily high proportion of the dead were young adults. Nearly one half of the dead were between 20 and 45 years of age, despite the fact that so many of the young men were away waging war. Reports from Paris showed the same disturbing age incidents. Spanish influenza attracted a lot of attention in Europe in the summer, more certainly than either the Americans or Europeans had paid it in the spring, but got only a fraction of the notoriety that its sweep across the continent would have earned it in peacetime. Wartime censorship guaranteed that. And besides, for medical men and women, as well as for the lay population, the war was much more interesting than flu. July found Private Presley in England, possibly temporarily immunized against flu by his brush with it at Camp Dix. On the 10th, he wrote his girlfriend back home that London, in common with the rest of the Eastern world, has had an epidemic of Spanish flu. It seems to cause a heavy fever with a complete feeling of weariness and usually only confines the patient to bed for a few days. Robert Graves, the poet and British Army officer, was in London too, still shaky from the German medal he had received in his chest and thigh the year before. His mother-in-law contracted influenza, but deceived her physician in order to make the rounds of the latest London plays with her son, Tony, on leave from France. She died July 13th. Her chief feeling was one of pleasure that Tony had got his leave prolonged on her account. On the day she died, Graves' friend and fellow poet, Siegfried Sassoon, who had been shot through the throat in 1917, was shot through the head while on patrol in no man's land. He recovered. Tony was killed 2 months later. Yes, the war was much more engrossing than Spanish flu. Spanish influenza didn't restrict itself to North America and Western Europe, of course. In the middle of June, British forces embarked for Murmansk, had an epidemic of flu on the way, and doubtlessly deposited it in Russia when they got there. Other ships carried it south, east, and west. It had appeared in North Africa as early as May, sprung up in Bombay and Calcutta in June, and spread widely throughout India in the next 2 months. In the same period, it sprouted in China. It was said that at the end of July, half of Chongqing in the deep interior was down with grip. By then, it had already reached New Zealand and the Philippines, crippling Manila's dock facilities by laying low three-quarters of her longshoremen. Spanish influenza had rounded the globe in 4 months following its appearance in the United States and fully earned a promotion from epidemic to pandemic. It had infected so many that, for all its mildness, it had doubtlessly killed tens of thousands already. In its next wave, it would kill millions. As of midsummer, the most striking aspect of the epidemic was its absence from the United States. It seemed to have North America under siege, with epidemics ranging widely among peoples across the oceans to east and west, and even raging in islands and lands close by with which the United States was almost in daily contact by ship. Spanish influenza surfaced in Cuba and Puerto Rico early in the summer, and an estimated 10,000 fell ill in San Juan. In July, it raced through the troops stationed in the Panama Canal Zone. Ships from Japanese and Chinese ports brought it to Hawaii the same month, and the epidemic there lasted through July into August. And yet it did not reach, or at least did not penetrate, North America or South America, if the dearth of reports of influenza there is accepted as conclusive evidence. Early in the summer, ships with crew members sick with flu and pneumonia began to arrive in North American ports. On June 22nd, the city of Exeter, last port Liverpool, arrived at Philadelphia with 27 Lascars and an English quartermaster so desperately ill with pneumonia that they had to be taken to a hospital immediately. The Somali, from India, steamed into the Gulf of St. Lawrence and put 89 of her crew, ill with influenza, ashore at Gros Isle. In August, a vessel, nearly all of its crew down with flu, limped into the harbor of Newport News. About the same time, a transport steaming from Europe to America had 42 cases of flu on the high seas. On the return voyage to Europe, she carried soldiers of the 64th Infantry, and 100 of them were stricken with flu on the way. The Norwegian vessel, Bergensfjord, arrived in New York Harbor on August 12th. She had had 200 cases of influenza and 3 deaths while at sea. 11 passengers were transferred to a hospital in Brooklyn. They were not placed in isolated wards. Health Commissioner Royal S. Copeland of New York City allayed fear by announcing that all the sick put ashore had pneumonia now, not flu. Besides, he said, Spanish influenza seldom attacks the well-nourished. You haven't heard of our doughboys getting it, have you? You bet you haven't, and you won't. No need for our people to worry over the matter. Dozens of ships with cargoes of influenza came to American ports. But except for an isolated outbreak of what was diagnosed as the usual mild flu at Fort Morgan, Alabama, nothing much happened. Had the spring epidemic been so widespread in the United States that its citizens had herd immunity? That is, was the situation such that the disease might infect a few, but so many were immune that it couldn't spread? All we know for certain is that North America was surrounded by epidemics of a very infectious disease in the summer of 1918, and yet that disease could not penetrate beyond the coastline. The characteristic of the influenza virus that makes it so dangerous and gives rise to epidemic after epidemic is its extreme mutability. It perpetually is changing the nature of its outer surface, which antibodies, the body's most important defense system, must zero in on to be effective. The body's defenses against flu are always becoming obsolescent and periodically become obsolete, which means worldwide pandemic. While North America was passing through summer 1918 peculiarly free of influenza, the virus of Spanish influenza was passing through millions of hosts in other continents and changing as it adapted genetically to the multitude of its new environments. As the epidemic declined in August in London, for instance, its special propensity for killing young adults declined also. This, however, might have been because it had already claimed all the especially susceptible in that age group. But in that same summer, doctors in France, both in the AEF and in civilian practice, had the impression that as the number of cases shrank, the proportion of those whose illnesses lasted longer and were more serious rose. We don't even have impressionistic remarks about how the character of Spanish influenza may have been changing in the rest of the world. The situation was dangerous because it was such as to maximize the exchange and propagation of different strains of flu viruses by people who were radically different immunologically. Because of the war, thousands of ships were traveling between Europe and all parts of the world, carrying unprecedented numbers of all kinds of people. A July epidemic at the United States Naval Base Hospital No. 2 in France is an example of how dangerous the wartime mixing of peoples and influenza strains could be. 19 Hindus, all from a single ship and all sick with flu, were admitted. And in 2.5 weeks, this Hindu influenza afflicted 41% of the hospital's staff, which up to that time had been only mildly affected by the local brand of the disease. Especially ominous was the transfer to Europe of hundreds of thousands of Americans. In June, 279,000 American soldiers crossed the Atlantic. In July, over 300,000. In August, 286,000. In the last 6 months of the war, 1.5 million Americans crossed to wage war in Europe. No such migration had ever been made before in such a short time, and never before or since in the midst of a pandemic. 1.5 million men were passing from a land where there was no influenza pandemic to a continent where there was. It is difficult to imagine, says the official history of the United States Army Medical Corps in World War I, a greater opportunity for enhancement of virulence by rapid passage from man to man of the organisms causing influenza and those producing secondary infections. Despite New York City Health Commissioner Copeland's statement, health officials were worried. On August 9th, the U.S. Navy Bureau of Medicine and Surgery in Washington, D.C., issued a precautionary bulletin, warning that influenza was prevalent in Europe, Hawaii, and elsewhere, and describing its symptoms, incubation period, and the recommended treatment. On August 16th, the Surgeon General of the United States Public Health Service, USPHS, ordered the medical officers in charge of the quarantine stations in the various ports to be especially alert for influenza on vessels from European ports and to hold ships with flu patients on board until the local health authorities were notified. There wasn't anything more the USPHS could do. Federal authorities did not have the legal power to quarantine influenza any more than measles, whooping cough, or any other common and usually mild disease. Even if quarantine had been possible and potentially effective against flu, a strict maritime quarantine on the ports of the United States was politically impossible because it would have sharply reduced the flow of troops and supplies to the Western Front. Shortly after the docking of the Bergensfjord, Colonel S.M. Kennedy, chief surgeon of the New York port of embarkation, said that ships with flu cases...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.